checked on Craigslist, and there was a posting from Industrial Light Magic about Star Wars and needing, well, they didn't say Star Wars, but Industrial Light Magic, they're doing all these big movies. I'm like, oh, that's Lucas Digital, it's Star Wars. So I applied, and they called me, and then I went through like this process of like, over 3 months, I had like 4 different in-person interviews and met like all these people. It was a crazy, I'd never been through a process like that before. But eventually got the job and started working on Star Wars. And this was Phantom Menace, episode 1, which was, you know, the George rebooting the next 3 or whatever, in this like late 90s. And I can talk about that in detail on ILM and stuff, but working on ILM was amazing. I got to work with Dennis Muren. I was his assistant. He's like this legendary visual effects guy who started on the original Star Wars. He's won like 8 Oscars. He did Jurassic Park with Spielberg. He won an Oscar for that. He won an Oscar for Close Encounters. Like, I mean, and he was one of the ones kind of that ushered in the birth of digital filmmaking between, they started doing like the water creature in James Cameron's movie.
Avatar.
Avatar.
Oh, no, way before that.
The Abyss.
Thank you. The Abyss, and then and T2 with the metallic thing, and then it became Jurassic Park, all that stuff. Anyway, so Dennis was great, and he kind of became my mentor when I was there, and just working on Star Wars, the whole experience was really cool. They had a unit called the Rebel Mac unit at the time, which was just a bunch of artists using Macintoshes, which was kind of different, and it was kind of streamlined, where only a couple artists could do shots, and it wasn't like this big apparatus of all the other visual effects stuff going on. So it was great hanging out with those guys, and they left after Star Wars and stuff to start their own company called The Orphanage. And they're orphans from George Lucas, kind of where the name came from. Everyone always asks me, so you worked at an orphanage? I'm like, no, it's not an orphanage, it's a video effects company. And they were doing all this stuff on Macintoshes and using After Effects and everything, which was new at the time as far as this visual effects pipeline stuff. So the orphanage was started by a bunch of great young artists, Stu Maskowitz and Jonathan Rothbart and Scott Stewart, who have all like gone on to other bigger and better things. Like Jonathan Rothbart was just the visual effects soup on Deadpool, if anyone saw that, but he's done a bunch of movies, but that was his most recent movie. Anyway, they started the orphanage. We were in the Presidio. I was there for a couple years. We did like we did Sin City, which was fabulous, which was a very unusual experience the way we did that. Which I thought was a really groundbreaking film at the time. Not only because it was shot on digital video, and the whole movie was green screen, the entire movie was green screen. So every shot in that is a visual effects shot. But just the look and the style, and Robert Rodriguez, we did Spy Kids movies. I did Hellboy there, Day After Tomorrow. Just a bunch of really cool, like, you know, tentpole movies, I guess, so to speak. So that was a really, and actually before I even got there, I did video games for a while, so I can talk about that too later if anybody wants to know a little bit about video games. I did an Xbox video game. It was a first generation for that was Bruce Lee, which was great because the game didn't turn out all that great, but we got to work with the Bruce Lee estate and work with Universal and Microsoft because it was a first generation game, and got to learn all about Bruce Lee, who I thought was fascinating. And so after a couple years at the orphanage, I was like, you know what, I really want to get back to indie filmmaking and kind of shake up, and I guess, my life a little bit. I hadn't ever lived in LA, and I was like, I want to get back to making movies. So I decided to apply and get in and go to AFI. So I went to the American Film Institute for producing, my master's in producing, which was fantastic. Learning a little bit more about the producing side, the finance side, the business side, and shooting in LA and doing a couple thesis films, which my thesis film Smoke, the first time I ever came to Palm Springs, it got in the Palm Springs Shorts Fest, and I came here. That was the first time, like 2007, that I came ever been to Palm Springs for the festival, and fell in love with Palm Springs, and then my wife and I started vacationing more, which will lead up to where we're at now. So, and then post-AFI, I spent like a year doing, trying to do a television, pitch a television series, go around, and that was an interesting experience as well. As well as just developing scripts, writing scripts, all that kind of thing, and raising financing. Because most of the job as a producer really is trying to find money and trying to partner people with money or have companies or even, you know, developing projects, all that kind of stuff. And it's definitely a tough road, and that's changed over the years a lot. As well as doing visual effects, I continued doing visual effects. I worked for a title company. It's like a major titles company and does all the big Hollywood movies, including doing the movie Gamer, stars visual effects, and then doing title sequences in 3D for like Yogi Bear and Shrek. And so I started doing a lot of 3D stuff because it was just starting to get really big there in the late 2000 aughts, what do you want to call it, 2008, 2009, 10, all that kind of stuff. And all that during that time, I'd worked for a sales agent a bit, was going to AFM a bit, you know, trying to basically get my other projects going. And that's kind of how Palm Springs came to be, which is a film I shot here in Palm Springs. And that was a project that my wife and I were vacationing here, and we came up with this idea and decided that we really wanted to hire a writer. And there was a writer I knew, Amanda Lockhart from AFI. And asked her if she'd be interested, and she was. And so we started from an idea we had. She wrote the story and the script, everything. And that took about a little under 2 years from when we first had the idea to when we were shooting, which is actually pretty quick. I've had a lot of projects that still haven't happened yet. It's been a lot longer than 2 years. But we went through probably 12 drafts over that kind of 2 year span, I guess. And what had happened was I had met, this is kind of how producing works. I met a guy from Dallas who was in LA, wanted to be a film producer. He's in the oil and gas business. We'd met at the producers conference. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of the PGA, the Produce By Conference. It happens in June every year, and they just had like the sixth or seventh one, I guess, that's going on. It's great, amazing conference, one of the best conferences you'll ever go to as far as like all the big top producers, directors in Hollywood go. It's at one of the studios every for that like 3 day weekend kind of thing, and it's put on by the Producers Guild. It's an amazing conference with just seminars and panels and nuts and bolts and all kinds of stuff. So I met him just by randomness and started talking, and he wanted to get in the movies and he had some money, so we were like, okay, great. And then I pitched, this project was, Palm Springs was pretty far along, and I got invited to pitch it at this conference, which is the Winston Baker Conference, which they do conferences all around the world, but they have their big Hollywood one in March. And I pitched it there, and I met someone there who was like, yeah, we love this project, and we'll give you some money. So we basically just cobbled together a bunch of private equity money, and we started pre-productions, and I get into the details of that, and shooting, and then we shot here in Palm Springs, and we're in the process now of finishing up, and we've had many offers, but we finally decided on one from a distributor, and we're looking to get it done and start showing it at AFM, which is in November, which is the big American film market, which is, other than Cannes, is the biggest film market in the world, and Cannes obviously is in France, and in May, and AFM is in November in Santa Monica, and it's just where all the distributors and sales agents and everybody, that they all come to Santa Monica for like a week, and it's just the buying and selling of movies in the outside of the studio system, which is probably 90% of the movies that are made are outside the studio system, even more so maybe today because studios seem to make less and less. So that's in a nutshell, I guess, so to speak, kind of how we got here. So, Palm Springs. So, some of you probably heard about the movie. Yes, it's about swingers. That's what everyone's like. You know, everyone has this preconceived notion because of the subject matter, which some people look as controversial, other people don't. You know, but we chose the subject matter just because we thought it would be cool. But also, I'm a big fan of 70s movies, and I thought it would be a great kind of introduction to what's essentially this movie about this young couple's relationship and their love story and going in and out of love and about their relationship. And so we thought this would be a great background, and especially because we got inspired by Palm Springs and just being here a lot, of how mid-century modern architecture and the 70s and the vibe and feel of the movie. And obviously, in choosing an indie movie, you want something that's got something of a hook to it, where people can instantly either love or hate, which kind of works great, because I don't really care if you hate it, and obviously I want you to love it, but I want you to talk about it, I want you to have an opinion about it, I don't want you to just shrug your shoulders after me, whatever. So I knew it was a good subject matter because it was very attractive to all the distributors we were talking to, because again, as an indie movie, which is, it's just a low budget movie, it was a SAG ultra low, which means it's like an under $250,000 movie. Everyone's basically made, I call it a minimum wage movie, because that's what everyone's making minimum wage that worked on it. And that's kind of how, I'm not gonna say negative, 75% of the movies that are made nowadays, that's what they are. They're like under $200,000, they're just super low budget movies, and it's like, it's trying to get that traction and attention. And that's kind of where we are always at. We're like, okay, we're disguising this romance drama movie, but we're putting this hook onto it, which is, again, very important from a distributor standpoint. Because distributors in general and the way the business works is there's only a handful of movies they truly, truly want, let's be honest. They're thrillers, always sell. Comedies, to some extent, they always look for them because comedies do well in the U.S. They don't travel very well, but still, they like comedies. But thrillers, comedies, action. In an international market, it's typically thrillers and action. And there's hybrids of that to some degree. And then family films. Those are pretty much the genre. And family films, typically, they gear more towards animated because they think a little more towards kids. It can also be family films that are live action too. But in general, they kind of put family films in this animated kind of category. So from an international level, in terms of how movies are put together, when you're outside the studio system, I mean, your choices are you get a bunch of private equity, just cash, you know, together, and you make your movie. Or you kind of play this sales international game, which is they typically only want those categories that I just listed. So if you're a drama, which half or more than half the movies made are dramas, but unless you have these huge stars or, again, a hook of some way, like, they're so hard to get people to distribute. There's so many movies nowadays, especially. There's so much content being made. And it's like feeding the beast. So people want content, but at the same time, from a buyer's or distributor standpoint, there's so many choices out there that they can be picky. And even though a lot of those choices are super low budget, so the quality's out there, so they instantly are kind of pushed aside. So you're playing this, like I said, this game of, okay, the next game, of course, as part of that is, you know, who's in it? Who's your star? All that kind of stuff. So I'm giving you a broad thing of how Palm Springs came together. But in our case, we knew we had a hook. We knew we had distributors interested. So we went ahead. We had the private money, at least, to get the movie done and that kind of thing. And so, you know, our next biggest step, usually in any production, is, and this went fast, too, but is a casting director. Casting director is a huge part of indie filmmaking because they have the relationships that kind of open up the doors to get your cast. And it gives me as kind of a filmmaker who had done a film 20 years ago, but didn't really, like, no one's ever heard of, and it's like, you can get it on Amazon and stuff. But I mean, essentially I'm an unknown filmmaker and basically a new filmmaker to everybody you know, in Hollywood today. So having a cast agent helped us a lot, because then that opened up the doors to the agencies to take the script seriously, and then to have those and be able to talk to actors as far as having them come in for auditions and all that kind of stuff. So and then so there's again, getting the cast at this budget level is difficult, because we're not paying people, except it's a SAG ultra low. So actors are, they're making $100 a day. But you're like, how in the world can they do that? Well, they want to be in stuff that's interesting or different or whatever. So me as quote unquote a first time filmmaker, we're doing a movie that's SAG ultra low, and there's nudity in it. So we instantly, like, a lot of the actors, or agencies or whatever, they just instantly said, no way, just go away. But we were able to get a lot of great talent interested, and so we had Diane Farr, who plays one of the leads. She was in, she's known for Numbers, for several seasons on Numbers, and done several other, Californication, she was in Rescue Me. She's in this new series called Chance, which is on Hulu with Hugh Laurie, that's coming out like in a month. So she's done indie films, but primarily a lot of television. And then Jason Lewis from Sex and the City fame, a lot of television, but you know, that kind of thing. Sugarlyn Beard was our lead. She's a Canadian actress and has gotten really big actually in the last year or so with, she's one of the voices in Sausage Party. She was the lead, like the sister in Mike and Dave Need Wedding Date. She's been in a bunch of other, like, smaller roles in bigger movies, but she had big roles in those movies. So her status has gone way up in the last year or so. Let's see, Madison McKinley, that was in Wolf of Wall Street, and Dia Carrera, a lot of people know from True Lies and Wayne's World and stuff like that, and she's been around for a long time. She's probably the name that most people know just because she's been around a long time. When she was fantastic, So she plays the head of the swinger party. Her name is, she's the host. Her name's Cherry Bomb in the movie. So the process was really quick. I mean, we do start doing pre-production. So we'd already been coming to Palm Springs a lot and knew and kind of had an idea where places we wanted to shoot. So we had a fantastic local person. His name is Kip. I don't know if anyone knows Kip. Kip Serafin. He's based here in Palm Springs. He does all huge events in Palm Springs. He's a location manager. He does all the big films that come into town. He does also, like, if anyone knew about the Louis Vuitton event that was done at the Bob Hope, he put that on. He does a lot of stuff with the Dinosaur House and Lautner Hotel. And so he does all the year-round events, but he's also a location manager and does films and stuff. So I met Kip early on, like a year before we even shot here. And we started looking at locations and planning stuff. And the city was great. The city had at the time, I think they still have it, the rebate that they do there. If you spend $25,000 in the city, they give you $5,000 back, which we easily spent that on our locations and our hotel, because we brought a lot of our cast and crew from LA. We had some local people, but most of the people came from LA, and primarily because there are some good crew here, but they're also union and more expensive, and I have my AFI connections, and again, when you're doing a movie where people are making $100 a day, it gets, you know, it gets a little difficult sometimes to have people want to work for that, and I totally get it. So what we did was, again, Kip was great in terms of our liaison with the city, in terms of doing, the permits are really easy here, which is great. I mean, Palm Springs was great. We shot in Desert Hot Springs, Palm Desert. And the paperwork is very simple. They're very easy to deal with. They're more than accommodating the whole time we were there. We had no problems whatsoever. It's a very easy process. The permits are very cheap compared to obviously shooting in LA or something like that. And we rented out the Skylark Hotel for a full 3 weeks, not only did we shoot there, because a third of the movie takes place at the hotel, but then all the casting crews housed the hotel too. So we just took over the whole entire hotel, which was fantastic. And if you've ever been to Skylark, it looks great on film. And we actually learned later that it actually used to be a swinger hotel back in the 70s, which I thought was kind of funny. They told us that, the owner did. But it would, excuse me, it recently had been remodeled, and we shot there like only about a year after it had been remodeled, and the place was fantastic. So we shot at the Purple Room, we shot at Trio, we shot in downtown. We shot in a fabulous mid-century modern house that was a Alexander and Las Palmas neighborhood, old Las Palmas neighborhood. And we shot like in Twin Palms neighborhood south of another house, like around Smoke Tree. And then we shot in a house north of Palm Springs, it was also mid-century modern. We shot at College of the Desert. We shot at Anahata Springs out in Desert Hot Springs. So we kind of got a full kind of range of the valley as far as shooting here, which was fantastic. The shoot was quick. It was like 3 weeks. Like I said, most of our almost all of our casting crew came from LA. We had a couple local actors. Adina Lawson, maybe. Adina, she's from here. We probably had four or five people that had speaking roles that were local. Stephanie Bell, if anybody knows Stephanie, a local producer, she helped do all our casting locally, which was fantastic. And I'd known Stephanie for like 10 years previously from an AFI short I did with her. There's something else. Oh, I know what I was gonna say. So I had a fantastic, a lot of these people I worked with previously, like the DP, Kristen Fieldhouse, she's a British DP I knew from AFI, production designer, Rachel Payne, who I knew from AFI as well, was a fantastic production designer. So I had all these people that I worked with previously, the sound guy, Fred, so we had a really great like working relationship, which is important because you're doing work for like three all this in like 3 weeks, because we basically shot like 3 weeks straight, like 12-hour days, and we shot in summer, so it was like it was a month of June. So you know, and a lot of it's half of it, most of it's taking place at night, I would say. But you know, when you're shooting at night and it's still like 100 at 3 a.m, it's like it's tough shooting here, especially in the summertime. It's really tough, but it added a lot to the movie, which is great because a lot of times we had this. The mister is always going at the Skylark at night, and so between it lit up in the night, and then you see the misters, and it's just like, it just feels like I campaigned so hard with my producers. I'm like, I don't want to shoot just some exteriors in Palm Springs. I want to shoot the whole movie here, because I just wanted to ooze into the movie, and I feel like it really does. And not only just seeing stuff, but I mean, it just shooting in a place. I've shot a lot of films on location. There's something about being on location that just adds more to your movie than just like, okay, we'll do some exteriors and then shoot the interiors in LA. Because you get a bonding that goes on. I always like to call it like film camp with the cast and crew and everything, just being together in a location, you start to feel that, I think, on screen. And certainly as a director, that's what I wanted. Because you know, when you shoot in LA, yeah, you could fake stuff, and maybe some people would never even know that's true. But you know, people they work in LA, they go home to their lives, they do all that. They, you know, it's like a back and forth. It's a work thing, but you don't get the atmosphere that sometimes just the word magic can happen, as I like to call it, because you're on set or in the real location for that time frame. So we're editing now. I'm very old school, so we didn't do any social media stuff. We haven't talked about the movie that much. We hardly did any press at all. I'm really on in kind of the viewpoint where it's like, look, we're an indie movie, no one really cares. So if until the point where the movie's done and then maybe people get to see it, that's when they care. But prior to that, then it's just like, I feel like I've worked with other filmmakers where all they do is they update and talk about stuff, but then nothing ever happens. So then people just, after 6 months, go, whatever happened to your movie? And you're like, oh, well, I'm still working on it or whatever. But then some people lose interest rather than, so I kind of took the old approach where I'm like, let's just don't do anything. Let's just finish the movie and then we'll talk about it after a fact. So, it's very difficult to find anything online. We don't publish that we haven't done anything just because we haven't gotten to the point where, we want to do that. So, that's in a nutshell. Let me just open up the questions because I'm curious what you guys want to ask. I know it's a screenwriting thing. I'm happy to talk about any parts of that and that process as well. But I want to just give you a background of what it was like. And I'll answer any details about shooting here too. So specific, let's start with some.
I just want to say one thing.
Yeah.
He thinks that there's not much out there, but believe me, when it was brought up that he was going to be addressing our group, unbelievable, the underground information out there about the porn flip that he's put together and stuff. It took me almost 2.5 days to finally just call him up and say, look, this is what I'm hearing, what is this, you know, and so that's why it's just, I also want to let you know that-
You mean it's not porn? Darn.
No, it's just a radar movie, but people have opinions about this subject, and that's great. That's what you want, actually, and that's what we're looking forward to, that we want a subject matter sometimes that strikes a chord in people, and that's what I look for as a producer or as a director. I mean, I don't want people to think too that, oh, well, that's the kind of movies you make, because like my wife and I are writing now a new script for Palm Springs right now that it's about this, my wife's a nurse, and it's about this nurse caring for her dying patient, and it's all based in Palm Springs, and it came from some experiences we've had in Palm Springs since living here, and it's a very heartfelt kind of terms of endearment type of movie, so it's so different than this movie right now that we're finishing, but that's like, as a filmmaker, I mean, yeah, the last thing you want to do is get pigeonholed in something. So just like I don't want people to think that maybe Palm Springs is something that it's not, at the same time, I'm embracing the fact that if they want to make it into some controversial thing, because a lot of times you hear about movies that are controversial, and it's just like, it's a buzz thing, and then, and you see it, and you're like, what's this controversial about? But it's just a way to sell a movie too sometimes, so why you gotta embrace that.
I also want to do two other things. When he was mentioning about the locations person, actually you have an advantage, because if you ever get to the point where you're shooting locally, Levi is a locations person. And then thanks to Mike Colonna, when we had Levi speak at a meeting, he introduced him to somebody, and now they have donated to the Greater Palm Springs Film Alliance, a 900-acre shooting ranch, and it just recently opened. And so there's a lot of opportunities, a lot of additional opportunities to shoot locally.
Yeah, and Levi is great. He wasn't in his position wasn't around when we shot, so I didn't bring him up, but I've met him since then, and Levi's been fantastic and supportive of the movie, and as well as a lot of other people in town, stuff like that. And I'll mention too, also, that I was a big fan of Shag coming here. I'm sure people know who Shag is. And we were lucky too, because we reached out to him, and we provided all the artwork in the hotel. So all his artwork is all through the hotel. And we're talking to him now about doing the poster and some other stuff involved with the movie. So they were really, again, it's just another very supportive person locally in the scene that, when you heard about the movie and heard what it was about and everything, he's like, yeah, okay, that'd be cool. And so we had a great opportunity to meet him early on, put all his artwork in the movie, which looks fantastic. So,
how much did you pay a writer?
2% of the shooting the shooting budget, and it's based on anywhere between, like, you put a floor and a ceiling in the contract. So typically the floor, in this case it was lower, but if I know a movie is going to be kind of expensive, and it's going to be at least not like this movie, which I knew already going in it was going to be fairly inexpensive. But if you know the movie's going to be at least $1 million or more or something like that, typically I'll do like a floor $10,000 for a new writer. I'm talking for a new writer. A floor $10,000 and then a ceiling of WGA minimum. So WGA minimum, you know, it always goes up a little bit. I think right now it's around, I think it's 60,000, I think, for a feature script. So typically, like I said, you'll do a ceiling, floor, like 10,000, ceiling and WGA minimum. For a first-time writer, you don't usually like to do anything above a WGA, like the ceiling is the maximum, like the maximum is the minimum of the WGA contract. Even if they're not WGA, it doesn't matter. You just kind of, you like to set that as a rule. But typically, especially in these super low budget things, yeah, the purchase price is like 2%, and then there's back-end participation, like with net profits, and then also like if to be involved if there's a sequel or it turns into a TV series or something like that. So there's percentages based on that as well. If it's a known writer and he's done other stuff, I mean, you know, there's so many different ways to do a contract. But I it's hard as an indie producer in my position to pay too much up front. Like maybe I'll do like my deals typically are maybe like $500 for the first year for like an option. And then, you know, like I said, it's based on the if the movie gets going, then the purchase price is set in there. Or if the movie doesn't get going, like there's the right for me to re-up the option for like another year, or maybe even a second year if there's proof that, you know, we're involved with a production company or something might happen. So it's not a lot. It really isn't. I mean, you're lucky if you're unless you're an established writer. I mean, even a big producer with a new writer, I mean, they're still not going to, even for an option or something, they're not going to pay more than a couple grand for maybe a year for an option. Or they might just buy something outright, but even that, they're not going to do anything big. I mean, especially in the studio system nowadays, when everything's based on pre-existing properties, like a huge book, comic book, you know, a remake, all that kind of stuff. I mean, it's, you know, that's where they're spending all the big money. That's where, like, you know, the writers, like, with huge agents or track records or whatever get hired.
Would you get WGA credit?
It depends. If the company, if the producer and the company are registered to the WGA, like we weren't. The only union we dealt with, is SAG. Because we had SAG actors. And as an indie film, it's like, you almost got to have somebody with some name in it. So you almost pretty much have to do SAG. So that's the only union we dealt with. We didn't deal with IATSE because, again, super low budget. I wasn't DGA as a director. The writer wasn't WGA as a writer. But you can, I mean, you know, it's easy. Like, as a producer, I can sign a WGA contract. I mean, it's no big deal. It's just like, and then you agree to follow those rules and stuff like that. Which, if unless you're, oh boy, even the low budget WGA, as I was just talking about, I mean, at least your budget on your movie probably has to be at least a couple million dollars to be able to support the WGA or BDGA or BIATSE. I mean, it's got to be at least probably 3 million or so, maybe 2.5. I think that's the threshold for the next SAG one. It's like 2.5, because not only are you paying the rates, which they're reasonable, and again, I'm not a non-union person. Believe me, I'm all for like having unions because I know how difficult it is making a career in the industry. It's just so hard under today's economics to make it work. Especially when everyone wants to do a movie as cheap, dirtly cheaply as possible. So not only is there the cost of that, but then there's the cost of residuals and stuff later on. So for example, like, okay, our costs are really low to SAG as far as we were paying like SAG Ultra Low and all that kind of thing. But we still, once the movie gets out there and gets distributed, we still have to pay like residuals for the health and stuff like that. Which is fine, that's really great. But if we were also WGA, DGA, which I would love to be DGA because it could be more rights as a director, But WGA, DGA, IATSE, all that, those also you have to pay into the pension and percentage and stuff like that. So as an indie film, it's not just the money up front, but then on the back end too. So it's just really hard unless you, again, have a budget that supports that. Now, if it's a company in Hollywood doing business, selling stuff, whatever, yeah, they can't, it's hard for them to really get around that. I mean, you know, that's they're in the system, I guess, so to speak. We're still kind of on the outside a little bit. I mean, I'm a member of the Producers Guild. I've been a member for a long time, but the Producers Guild isn't a union. It's kind of like, you know, it's club, basically, which is fantastic, but it's they perceive producers as being management, as people who make decisions, so they can't be a union. So that's kind of the distinction as well, because they're responsible for hiring as opposed to being hired. So the PGA will, even though it's a great organization and it works, does a lot of wonderful things as far as doing the credits and ironing all that out and doing stuff like that. But it's not a union, so to speak. You had another part of your question? Or is that, okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, you were saying that most films are indie films because big studios don't have scripts or whatever. They're not taking risks.
So yeah.
If they cost you roughly $250,000 to make, how do you recoup that money? I mean, like your own film, where do you see that going? And people invested in your film, where do they come in? I mean, if you make a pile of money with this, are they guaranteed a percentage? I mean,
oh, sure.
They're investors, right?
Yeah, totally. So, you know, we set up a company, LLC, and they put money into the company. We use the money, we make the product. I mean, it's the same as if we were making a widget or whatever.
Yeah.
So what'll happen is we'll go to our distributor, will show the film at AFM and start making sales. There's, as far as selling your movie goes, I mean, the good news, it's a worldwide business. So, I mean, there's so many different ways to basically slice up the pie and make money, because you have U.S. distribution and you have these all these segmented rights to U.S. distribution, and those apply to every country in the world. So we have a sales agent, distributor, whatever you want to call it, and they'll go to AFM, they'll sell a movie, and they'll sell the rights for like U.S. distribution. Now that could be all in one. It could be all U.S. rights, or they could be like someone might just pick up theatrical. Someone might pick up VOD or digital. There's cable rights. There's, you know, basically it's theatrical. Used to be DVD and via and stuff like that. But that's still, people still sell DVDs. They haven't like stopped. It just doesn't make the money it used to. But DVDs and that kind of thing.
Mostly
and then
cable.
What's that?
Mostly cable.
Well, there's the selling of physical disc. Be it if you buy something on Amazon, you rent it on Redbox, you might still have a store or whatever. There's that. That's a right there. And then there's what's called SVOD, which is subscription video, which is something like Netflix, which is, or Hulu. So subscription means the person is buying a subscription and then you watch as many movies as you want. So that's a category. So then there's, what's it called? S, subscription VOD, what's the other one called? I lost it. Something VOD, I can't think of what it is. Anyway, it's like selling a copy of digital copies. So that's iTunes, Amazon, where you actually buy or rent a physical copy.
And then you get a cut of that.
And you get a cut of it. And then there's VOD, which is just selling like through Time Warner Cable or through subscription, or I mean, where you buy it like on your television set because you know, through Time Warner, or if you have Dish or if you have DirecTV or whatever. And then there's cable TV rights, and then there's, and there's free TV rights. So there's like eight categories to get divided up. Now, someone could buy US rights and buy it all, and then they basically then make money that way, or you can segment those rights. Typically, in today's world, they're just going to want to buy all the rights. So someone will buy all the U.S. rights. They might give you an advance. You know, who knows? They could determine what that number is. But then they go out and then, okay, maybe they'll do a small theatrical. For a movie like ours, it might be a small theatrical. It might be a 20-city release, or it might be smaller than that. You know, and I'll be like, oh, I want to make sure we do a release here in Palm Springs and L.A. and New York and places of markets I think it'll do well. And a lot of times for indie movies, they do that as kind of a, what's called a lost leader, where it's to publicize the movie. Because it helps your digital sales. So even though you're lucky, or I shouldn't say lucky, you're fine if you break even. Of course you want to do a really good theatrical, but if you break even, that's fine, because you're getting press, just like if you go to a film festival or whatever. It's about the press, the PR, getting stuff out there. And then they'll put it out on VOD, and then and sell through, like being like iTunes and Amazon, or whatever, they're actually selling a copy of the movie or selling a copy for you to rent.
So then it becomes passive income almost, right? It's just
like, well, what I don't know if passive is the right word, but it the process would be, you know, theatrical, could take some exposure, then you release it on VOD, then you sell it or whatever. It doesn't come on to Netflix or subscription for maybe like 6 months, and then it doesn't come on to free TV or cable TV like HBO or something like that till maybe a year, nine months to a year later. That's just, I'm just talking like the cycle of how your money comes in. So you're getting money from all those different sources. Now, typically it's gonna be anything from like maybe an 80-20, a 75-25 split in favor of the filmmaker. So, and then they'll have some, the distributor will have some expenses, you know, involved with that. But typically, you're gonna see, I'll give you an example. Here's, okay, for every dollar you make, I might have to pay 20 cents of that to my sales agent. And for their overhead. So let me back up one more step, actually. All right, so. I'm gonna try to keep it as simple as possible. Well, all right, let's make it 100. Actually, it's better than a dollar. So let's say 100. So for every $100 the movie makes, I guess, so to speak, first off, you've got the distributor who is like actually putting the movie on VOD, iTunes, Amazon. I mean, I could give you some examples of companies that do that. This distributor even could be like, you know, it could be Sony, it could be a big studio. It doesn't really matter. But let's say for every, they've got a deal, and these are very generic examples, because I'm just trying to show you a little bit of how the math works. But for they might have a 75-25 split. That's pretty kind of standard or whatever. So for every $100 you make, they're gonna get their $25, and then you're gonna be left with $75. Okay. Now, my sales agent, who's selling my movie worldwide, they're like the middleman. They are the middleman. So they're getting their cut. So let's say their cut is 20% or so. And again, this is pretty standard. So they're 20%. So there you go, $60. So for every $100 that we're making, then $60 is coming back to the movie. So then I've got to, for all this $60, first of all, I've got to pay back, it starts off, it depends on how the waterfall is with your investors. But in our case, it's pretty simple because we only have a few investors. But so for every, all the $60 comes back, first off, they get all their money back paying for the movie plus their premium on top of their money, which is, you know, whatever their premium was. I'm not going to say it was, but, you know, let's say it's 20%. So they're getting all the money back that they put into the movie plus their 20%. And so that's basically until we get to the break-even point. And now once we reach the break-even point where the investor's been paid back for the movie, then the other people start to share in the pie, be it the writer, the director, the other producers involved have a percentage, as well as our original investors, that basically, it kind of turns into a 50-50 then. Like, it turns into a 50-50 pot at that point. So once the movie's paid off, and all our investors get all their money back, and they've got their premium, and they're really, really happy, now the pot turns into a 50-50 pot. So 50% of it is still going to those people who paid for the movie, and so they're making more money, and they're really happy about that. And the other 50 is being split, well, usually determined by the producer creative side. So that's the writers, the DP, the actors, the everybody else. And that of that 50%, then you know, that could be split up between, you know, another 25, 30 different people or whatever. But since it's an international business, okay, we're only making 60 bucks for the 100. Every 100 we make, we're only getting 60 bucks. But again, there's all these, there's, like I said, 8 different categories within the US as a stepping stone that your movie starts making money. And 90%, maybe not 90, 80% of the money you're gonna make on your movie, you're gonna make it in the first like 2 years. And then it'll just, typically a movie can still make money over another 5 years or whatever, but it starts to trickle down. I mean, the bulk of what you're gonna make is in that first 2 years. But then your movie's also being distributed across the world. So, like for example, Netflix, they might buy your movie for the US, but they also can buy it for the world. So they might only give you, let's throw out a number, 50 grand for your movie. For the U.S., but they might decide, well, we want to buy it for the world, so then they might give you, like, they might double that, triple that, or whatever they determine the value of the movie is. And a company like Netflix, since they're subscription, they just pay you a lump sum. It doesn't matter how many people watch your movie, it doesn't matter whatever, they just pay you a lump sum. So they say, we have the rights to your movie for 2 years, and we're going to give you 50 grand. That's different than like when you're selling it individually, like on iTunes. So 1 month you might sell 5,000 copies on iTunes. That's great. And the next month you might sell 2,000. But then suddenly it hits and gets a lot of press, and somebody didn't know about it. So then the next month you sell 50,000 on iTunes or whatever. That can go on forever or whatever. And you're getting a percentage of sales, just like you would like a royalty in a way. It's not really a royalty, but it's like you're getting percentage of sales. And it's something like that. Well, I'll get back to one other thing. I'm talking about the $100 minus this, the distributor kind of thing. But I also, when it comes to something like iTunes, again, this is where everyone's getting their piece of the pie. So on an iTunes sale, iTunes is taking 30%. So your 100 really, oops, is now 70, and then you got to do what, 25% from 70, which, what is that left with? What's a fourth?
23%.
Yeah, it's kind of in there, yeah. So then if it is 23, then that's what, 47, and then you got to take 20% from there.
Now you're $10.
Yeah, so then, yeah, you're cutting down on that. So
it's a good thing you're a filmmaker.
Yeah, exactly. I'm good at math on the fly. So now of your iTunes sales, you're really only getting $40 of that $100 kind of thing. So it just kind of, everything's broken up a little differently, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
So in your world of indie films, and you know a lot about this, obviously, but are most indie films, do most of them make money, or just a few of them?
No. I mean, in general, 9 out of 10 films lose money. Yeah, and that's across the board, studios, whatever. I mean, you know, I think everyone probably heard how, you know, Ben-Hur was shot, they shot a scene here and they made a big deal about it. And Ben-Hur is going to be a gigantic loss for MGM. I mean, they're already reporting that they're probably going to lose like $140 million on that movie. So, and that's all loss. That's a huge loss for anybody, but a studio. I mean, that's a huge loss. Yeah.
Let's step back for a second. You've got your idea. Your palm swings.
Yep.
And you're looking for investors. So you got a couple of 2 or 3 people you're going to talk to.
Yep.
Now I'm curious on 3 different fronts here. Your pitch to them.
Yep.
And what they were going to get back for their investment.
Sure.
Number one. Number two, when you said you had a couple of SAG, 2 or 3, did you deal with their agents, and how much was there a minimum that you had to pay? And then basically, do you put the contract together yourself, or do you have a standard contract? Or is it specific for each actor?
Oh, for the actors?
Yeah.
Okay, those are good questions. First of all, I have an entertainment attorney. I mean, it deals with stuff, but most of the stuff at my level is fairly basic and also fairly standardized, I guess, so to speak. All right, so from the first thing, first question,
pitching
and investors. I create what's called like a pitch deck, which are like a lot of, you know, if you're doing any kind of business, it's almost like I The thing with movies, it's like you're starting a new business every single movie. So, I mean, there's some things that are in common, but it's like you're an entrepreneur every single time. You're starting over every single time. So I've gotten it down to where I've got like a pitch deck that I do where it's like, okay, it's who's involved with, you know, who's director, writer, who's involved with the project, maybe some ideas of who cast is going to be, the story. I put together projections, which is based on other films, comparables to other films that are of a similar nature and how much money they made. Maybe some, if I'm really lucky, I can even actually get some estimates from a sales agent where they could say, if you have a certain stars at this quality level, this is how much we can expect to make on a worldwide basis based on this type of movie or this type of stars, which is really important in terms of like trying to show people, not only do I think you can make this much, but I have a sales agent that thinks this is the value of the movie. And then I'll have stuff in there like, you know, pictures that I took or stylistical choices or pictures, like, and then, you know, sample ideas for cast, to break down the characters, the story, pretty much everything in terms of what I call look, it's also like a lookbook kind of thing, but very basic, but it still ends up being like 20 or 30 pages. That's something that would be like, that I could, you know, I could show someone, you know. Like,
this is all before you have a screenplay.
Well, I do this while I'm doing the screenplay, but usually it's the point where the screenplay is about done because, I mean, you know, you like to not show a screenplay until you feel like it's done. I mean, it's never done, but until you only get one shot usually with people because they only really remember the first time. And this applies to screenplays. It even applies to, like, when I show people a cut of the movie or something. They only really remember the first time and their first reaction to it. So your script can change, and you think it can be great improved, and it could be great improved. But the person who read it 6 months ago is not going to look at it that way. They're going to look at it going, I remember this, I read this story, and I either don't want to read it again, or I'll read it again, but then I have my preconceived notions of the first time I read it. So you really have to be careful with... You want feedback. I'm not saying no, because you need that. You need feedback. You need to be able to show people. But sometimes the best thing is, like, you know, maybe friends in the business, but not necessarily people that you want to approach to sell the movie to. Because it's good to have feedback, because sometimes it's like, you know, having people outside the business read a screenplay, that's like pulling teeth out. A lot of people don't. It's harder. Screenplays aren't the easiest thing to read anyway. And so when you're in the movie business, you kind of understand the process and how it works. But when you're outside the movie business, reading a screenplay is like, I don't understand. This is like, it's hard to read. It doesn't feel natural. It's not like reading a story. Like, it's hard to get it sometimes. So, but again, like I said, you want to get feedback. And so that is an important part of the process.
Did you do the pitch yourself to the investor, or did you have somebody else do it?
Well, and as a producer and director of this project, I mean, a lot of times I'm just a producer, but it's something that was close to me that I wanted to direct. I'm definitely involved. As a producer, I'm almost always involved with the pitch, but as a producer-director, I'm certainly involved. I put together the pitch deck, all this kind of stuff. The script was always going through different phases. And it wasn't really until we got to probably the, you know, 10th draft. I had other people read it, but it wasn't really until we got to the 10th draft that it truly felt like it was starting to be good, to be honest. Because, you know, you try a lot of different things, you go down dead ends, you throw out characters, you jumble stuff around, you're constantly, like, working on it with the writer. And so, and that's when you know something, you finally have something, too, because I was always talking about it, but of course the first reaction is, I don't want to move down swingers. What? No, that's stupid.
How many people did you talk to before you got your first investor?
Well, I already had my partner involved before. We were working on a couple other different projects before this idea came about, so he was already aboard. He already had money sitting there going, let's find the best project. And we tried some other ones. We had a horror script that we were gonna do in 3D too, that was, it had won, during the producers conference that I mentioned, the Produce By conference, they don't do it anymore, but they had a thing where they used to do like a, I don't know what you call it. What was it? It was, I don't know. They read a bunch of screenplays and they picked their favorites, and so it was kind of like an awards thing or whatever.
Project Greenlight, like.
Yeah, kind of. But all it was kind of trying to give exposure, like at the conference for like their favorite scripts, and then they let you do pitch meetings, stuff like that. So I had a script that won that, that I developed with another writer, or not. I should preface that by saying the writer wrote the script, and then we developed it to make it better, and then we won that, and then we spent a year trying to get that project made. And I like it, but the problem is, too, things are of their time. So at this time, the script felt really fresh. Looking at it now, it's not. Like, there's been other films that have come out that feel similar, and the idea is kind of past and all that kind of thing. So I don't know what's ever going to happen with that, but sometimes that's what happens. I mean, you get a project, a lot of people seem to like, we had some traction, we couldn't really ever get the other money together. And then it kind of feels stale, and then it feels like other movies came out. Because sometimes you kind of work in the zeitgeist too, where you have an idea, it's great, and then suddenly three other people seem to have the same idea. And that's, maybe you're just tapping into something, and that happens. But the problem is, if those other ideas are coming from established places in Hollywood, they get those movies made before you, and then you're like, shit, out of luck. So sometimes, and you gotta know, say when, and not only when to put away projects, but sometimes you gotta know too, where it's like, you could have a really, really great, well-written script, and you could be a great screenwriter, but if the idea isn't right for a movie or right for the time, then you're not gonna get anywhere. People might recognize you as a great writer, they might even hire you for something else. So sometimes, you just gotta know like when an idea isn't right, or when it's time. Maybe it's timing, but maybe it's just this idea is not right for a movie, and when to go, okay, look, maybe I can come up with a different idea or a better idea or whatever, and not keep working on an idea that basically is not gonna get you anywhere. And that's hard to do because, I mean, I had a TV series I worked on hard for like 2 years, didn't go anywhere. I had several other feature projects, some big, some small, didn't go anywhere, just like the horror one I was talking about. So then my partner, we still had the money, we were a partner, we were developing other stuff, and eventually that's when it took time, but eventually while we're looking for other stuff, we just kept working on Palm Swings to the point where we're like, you know what, this is the low budget movie we should be doing because it's unique and it'll stand out as opposed to, you know, the horror movie in particular, which felt stale, but also, yeah, you can do well with horror, but there's also a lot of people making a lot of horror movies, and a lot of them are bad, and a lot of them don't go anywhere, and so, you know, maybe that's not the best plan either. So, and there's a lot of different ways. I don't really like necessarily developing scripts from scratch, writing scripts. I do it because I feel like as an artist, I like to write, and I like to develop and whatever, but I also know going in, you know, that can be a 2 year process plus. Whereas if I find a script, which also can be hard to find a script, I'm not saying that's not hard either, but at least it's already like, hopefully you're far down the road already rather than starting from scratch. It's hard to start from scratch sometimes. So as far as that, then yeah, I had some money and then I found other money because I was pitching like at this various events. I'd go to companies and pitch, or I talk to people, but in specifically, it was this Winston Baker event where I got selected because of the project, and so I did a pitch in front of a room of like a couple hundred people, and somebody after that pitch came up to me and said, I think I have someone, and that led to like getting the rest of our money. So that's the first question. What was the second one?
The SAG, what was the getting in between your negotiations with them?
No, because it's a SAG ultra low, so I mean, the $100 a day, well, it's up now, it's like 125, it's basically minimum wage.
That's what extras get paid, usually, right?
On a union thing, yeah, yeah, totally. So, I mean, it's based on the SAG contract, so it's, when you're talking, you know, the minimums are set, so there's not much to negotiate. I mean, it's different than, that's scale, but it's low budget scale. So then scale, like on a typical scale, is more like 1,000 a day or something like that. But, you know, and again, you'll hear about actors getting scale like on a movie that might be like a big movie. Well, that's kind of what scale on a bigger movie would be. So there was no real negotiation. Most of the negotiation had to do with the fact, do they really want to do this? And basically that comes down to, well, if I don't want to do it, don't bother coming in to audition. So a lot of actors turned us down, not even wanted to audition, maybe because of the script, probably, maybe because I'm a new director, probably, also because of the money, you know, there's numerous factors. I mean, the agents were really great, and they want to, so they would mainly send a lot of unknown talent to us, which is fine, or I should say, talent has been in some things, but they don't have a name, which is great, because that's, you know, we ended up hiring some of those people, too. So, and then as far as the contracts and stuff, those are pretty standard. I mean, they're boilerplate kind of stuff, dealing with, you know, how they're credited in the movie, what their back-end participation is, you know, all that kind of stuff. So,
I just want to ask one question. Harmony has been gracious to say that because everybody seems really interested in the speaker, that if we want to continue asking questions, girls, do we want to move on to the second part? You know, I have one question. I know Connie had a question and somebody had a question.
See, my hour and a half is up already. See, I can talk forever. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, in recapping, let's get back to the basics. It's called, the title is Palm Springs Swings?
No, just Palm Swings.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay. That's okay.
I got to write this for the notes.
You know what that means?
Shut up. Anyway, so Palm Springs Swings.
Palm Swings. Yeah.
Okay, that's better.
Okay.
All right, so now you have a psychological love story, modern day, of a young couple, 20 to 30.
Yeah, what is your pitch?
What's my pitch?
Yeah, sorry, well, Connie. I want you to know the log line, but obviously this man's very talented, and he doesn't need the things that we might need. So it's about a psychological love story.
Why don't we just
come
give us
this
pitch?
Yeah, what's the log line? Well,
my quick pitch is this. It's about a newlywed couple that moves to Palm Springs, and they discover that their neighbors are swingers, and they decide to test their marriage and their love and experiment in the swinger scene. I mean, that's a general quick pitch to it.
Is it autobiographical?
What's that?
No, it's about you.
No,
lots
it's not.
Of research.
No, but in all, you know, what we started realizing was we had the idea, and again, I hired a writer to write the story and the screenplay and everything, but the original idea came from a place of wanting to do kind of a retro 70s fun movie about this couple. And it's about their relationship, but we wanted to put it, again, in this fun setting. And it came from inspiration of being in Palm Springs, loving 70s movies, and those style of movies, and actually being about, like, sexual politics and mores and all that kind of stuff. But in a modern-day setting, but still obviously using all the mid-century modern and kind of look and vibe and feel and stuff like that in the desert. So that's kind of where the inspiration came from. And then the more we started doing research, the more we realized that, you know, swingers are everywhere. I mean, they're all towns across the country.
All ages.
Definitely all ages. And, you know, and we met people here in Palm Springs. We had no idea if there was any kind of scene or whatever. And we actually met a couple people and started talking to them about what their experience was like in Palm Springs and all that kind of stuff. And so that's kind of just infused kind of, now, and a lot of it too, we made up. I mean, the idea, like, you know, there's this whole idea, like, of, you know, back in the 70s, key parties and stuff like that. So we made up this whole idea, like, okay, let's just do the whole thing where it's a swinger party at this hotel, but let's have, you know, them exchange room keys for the hotel. And I don't know, we just made it up. I didn't really hear it about it from anybody, but we thought this is kind of cool, where they're just throwing the room keys into a bowl, just like an old school thing, but it's a hotel room. And so, and that was just kind of made up as far as ideas. But then there are other stuff that came from real life and how, you know, and swingers communicate and all that. But our big thing too was, it's not a movie about judgment. It's a movie about just like, this is their lifestyle, this couple, you know, they decided to just to try to spice up their marriage and try this kind of thing, and it's how their relationship evolves in terms of, you know, wanting to try something new or whatever. But it wasn't any kind of, like, a lot of times, especially with like swingers or whatever, they try to like, they set a murder or a thriller or whatever, kind of thing. And we didn't really want to do anything like that. We wanted just to show the community as it was, not put any judgment on them, and actually reveal how, in our viewpoint, healthy their relationships are to each other in terms of how they deal with things as compared to how this couple's dealing with things, which they think they're healthy, but they're not. So that was kind of like a lot of the inspiration for the movie. But yeah, in a nutshell, it's about a young couple who moves to Palm Springs and discovers their neighbors are swingers.
Did you do rewrites while shooting?
No, it's a great question. Actually, we didn't have time. I mean, it was. We definitely had a locked script and going in, and the writer, Amanda, she hates production, and she actually didn't even come at all. She was more than welcome. I love writers. I've known Amanda for a long time. I'm like, hey, you can come to Palm Springs, and she's like, I don't care. I don't want to come. So she didn't even show up on set at all. And we didn't change anything during the production, although things do change because of actors. And the thing is, my style is very much, I was going for a very, what I would call like this magical realism, I guess, so to speak, where it kind of has a fairy tale quality to the story because it's a very structured story in terms of like a classic three-act structure kind of thing. And I always looked at it as kind of this fairy tale in a way about like this couple's relationship and what they get involved in, because it kind of is surreal and they're new to Palm Springs, so that's also kind of the fish out of water thing. So I always saw it as kind of, again, this magical realism kind of fairy tale thing. But I come back to the realism part because the dialogue and the actors, I was really important for me to have them naturalistic and grounded in the situations and not heightened in some caricature or comedy kind of way. There's some comedic elements, but a lot of people, I think starting out, thought we were doing a TNA comedy, and that's my fault, probably as a director, not expressing, like all my close collaborators, like DP, my production designer, all those, and the writer, all the producing part, they all knew the movie we were making. I had other people on the movie that weren't really sure at times what we were, because they kind of like were like thinking, like a lot of people do, they're like, ah, it's a swinger movie, it's a TNA kind of thing. And but the actors and everyone else involved like, really understood that what we were getting at was this kind of like this naturalistic realism. And again, I come back to these 70s movies that I grew up on, that I'm a big fan of just maybe the situation's a little heightened, but the actors, I wanted to make sure they were staying grounded and realistic in their portrayals of who they were. And so, in coming back to the script, there were many times where I let them go off book or off script and just kind of say what felt naturally. So there were certainly lines in the script that were key points that needed to be said or to drive the story along, or certain like phrases or lines that were important thematically to the movie. But I did allow a lot of freedom in terms of how they felt within the context of the scene to just make the dialogue their own at times. I'm not a stickler for the words exactly like they're on the page, except, like I said, in some situations where it's important that a line needs to be said or certain lines need to be said because it's, you know, an important part of the movie. But otherwise, yeah. So, yeah, there are points all the way through that basically the dialogue definitely changed. Yeah.
I have a question. We're planning to eventually have a pitch fest. From a producer's point of view, are you open and receptive to having a group of people pitch to you, and would you be interested in possibly picking up?
Oh yeah, always. That's what I do. I look for material. I mean, it's hard. It's you get so much. There's stuff. There's your own ideas. There's ideas from people I've worked closely with, and then you know, and there's you get outside ideas, and there's people I don't know that pitch me stuff, and so you get inundated constantly. And I'm not even at the middle of the food chain, so I can imagine what it's like. You know, how much material gets offered to people and pitched and all that kind of thing. And I also know how hard it is just to get anything made sometimes or all that kind of thing. So I certainly am always open. I mean, the biggest thing usually is like, yeah, it's like keep the pitches tight and short and all that kind of thing. And there's, sometimes it's, yeah, it's really, it does go down to ideas too sometimes, you know, and how you spark to those ideas. Like I just, do people know about Inktip?
I saw your name on there.
Oh, okay.
It pictured me too.
Oh, did they post it? They probably posted it because I just found the script on there. I've been on Inktip a long time. So yeah. If nobody knows about Inktip, check it out, inktip.com.
Yeah, I think I've sent hundreds of things to them.
Yeah, well, I mean, and
you have any success?
No.
No?
One.
You just, you never know. There's it's. I've found several scripts over the ages that I've optioned from there, none of which I've gotten made yet. I mean, obviously, I'm always hopeful. But yeah, the new one I optioned was from a Welsh, he lives in Wales, Welsh writer. And it just, the idea sounded really interesting to me. And primarily too, is I do look for projects that can be done on a low budget and those, even a micro budget kind of thing. And I spark to like sci-fi and thriller. I mean, I do look for those elements that I know are sell, like I have to know kind of what the sales companies want and what the buyers want. So it's not just always about like what I want. So it's kind of a combination sometimes. So I might work on a project that's very close to me that I know is gonna be tough to get made. Like I said, this nurse script in The Patient of Palm Springs that I'm writing right now, that my wife and I are writing, that's very personal. I know it's gonna be tough, but I have to look for stuff that's kind of commercial sometimes that also sparks to me. And in this case, this transference script was a sci-fi idea that I thought was really cool. And then when I read it, he's just is a really, really fantastic writer. I mean, and it came from a different point of view because, you know, he's not American, he's Welsh, and it just felt different and just, you know, that kind of thing. So I don't know. It's you hear something and just it kind of sparks to you. But, you know, as a writer, you're going to spend a lot of time on stuff. So again, I get back to the idea that, you know, make sure your idea is something that you really, really want to do for a long period of time. But you also got to have a little bit of your sense pulse, you know, pulse on we're in the movie business. So you got to have your pulse on maybe what the audience or the buyers or that people want. I mean, otherwise, you know, go write a novel and you know, that's great. Cause then you have total control, never worry about anybody.
So you think Inktip is, I'm enjoying it, but I'd be curious about it. I keep reading about it. I keep getting all their, you know,
and what is it?
Yeah,
it's
definitely safe. I don't know how it works exactly. Is right, like as a producer, I've been on it for like 10 years.
Yeah.
But they just give me a free thing because as a producer, I'm looking
right.
for stuff. But as a writer, I think is it a yearly fee? And
it's $60 for about 4 months, I think.
And then you can post your. It's not per script. It's just a.
Right. Well, you can respond to producers like yourself. Say I'm looking for this kind of thing,
right?
And then you write a your log line, a synopsis, your personal information, and then another thing, anything else you want to tell them.
But as a writer, it's not, they don't charge you per script. They charge you like
no,
it's like a
just,
couple
just
month
for,
fee.
Right.
Okay. I didn't know how they charge you because obviously that's they make their money from the writer side. And there's thousands and thousands of writers and material and
yeah.
and they used to have a. I say used to, but I haven't heard about it in a couple of years. They used to have a big convention like twice a year in Burbank where they would just do pitch sessions all day and all the writers would come. Maybe they only do it like once a year now, but
yeah.
I used to go to that all the time
so
too.
So that people that go to those pitch fests though, and they're disillusioned, so that's why they're actually hoping to visit.
Well, and
to have it here locally.
You're right. I mean, I'm not gonna like sure gloss it or sure coat it. I mean, it's not like
it's an education.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, the thing was is that they had advertised so many people were going to be there, and then they had selected, I'm gonna pitch to this, and they get there, and like, you know, six of the 10 that they had planned on pitching to, they didn't show it. And so that's why, you know.
Well, that's not good either.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think if you wouldn't mind, we would like to work with you. I know you're local, and we can, you know, have you back for other sessions on pitching maybe.
Oh, sure.
We do pitching. And we're going to do one, I think we have one coming up on concepts, you know, with just a panel,
no pressure,
you know, discussing like on the concept, you know, things like that. So if you have time and you're willing.
I totally will. I mean, because I live in the valley right now. I mean, I go back and forth between LA a lot and then trying to finish the movie right now. But, and like I said, I also work as, and have throughout my career as a writer. And, you know, like I said, a lot of it comes from, like, where do those ideas come from? And sometimes it's been great. Like, for me personally, like, the Valley and Desert's been great because I got out of L.A., I feel like, I think, and now I have, like, three ideas that I'm writing right now. And now I just feel like it just takes forever to write, or I don't have enough time to write. Sometimes I'm like, oh, what am I going to do? And now I have too many things to write, and I'm just trying to find the time to finish all of them, or try to write all of them as fast as possible. But I will say that in today's current status, where if you're not an established writer, you don't have an agent or manager, or haven't written a novel or a produced movie, screenplay produced into a movie, you know, you have, you know, this is my advice, but you have to focus on small stories. I mean, and small stories meaning, you know, again, it doesn't have to mean that it's like three people in a room, but it has to be something that feels realistic, small budget, and the kind of thing that a star would jump at. And do I have the secret to what a star would jump at and want to be in? No, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, actors are a strange breed. I mean, I don't know. It's like, it's hard to say exactly what they're looking for, you know, and everybody's looking for different things and that kind of thing. But I mean, in today's current economy, I mean, there's just kind of like I said, huge studio movies doing studio things. You know, the middle ground movies have kind of disappeared, and now what was once the middle ground movies are really only like these $5 to $10 million movies. And then the low-budget movies have suddenly become $1 million less, $500,000 and less,
and that's
really.
That's going to be because of cable, don't you think? I mean, really.
Well, it's the proliferation of content, but also because of the proliferation of technology. I mean, there's so many people who think they can be a filmmaker because they have a computer and a camera.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of people making stuff. And so, you know, and to their credit, I mean, the newer generation is, sure, they're making cheap, free stuff, they're putting it on the web, maybe turning a web series, whatever, and they get a track record, they get a following, they get a social media, and they're turning that into careers in Hollywood. And that is possible. But that's just kind of the way, you know, they're starting in what maybe once upon a time people started doing shorts, and people are doing shorts. But it's even less so in terms of even the money they're spending in terms of, but they're able to get it out into the world, and they might not make a penny, but they're getting those followings, and then those things suddenly are now what was once like this little web series on YouTube or whatever turns into a TV sitcom that's going to be on a network, because that's kind of like how they're looking for projects now. But yeah, I'd say 90% of the content being made now is it's really, really cheap. And they expect it to be cheap. And when you see the numbers, you know, I was talking about some of these numbers or whatever, but to do the math, if like a lot of indie filmmakers, if they're lucky to get distribution, that distribution probably is gonna be digital, VOD, all that kind of stuff. Maybe some international distribution into some countries, probably just English-speaking countries, you know, Australia, England, stuff like that. Maybe some in Europe or whatever to supplement some. Maybe, like I said, Netflix might just buy the world, and so they know they're going to get on. But all those numbers starting to get money back, or you know, the numbers I'm seeing, they're in the $200,000 to $400,000 range. So if that's all the money you can make on a movie that maybe had some success with, got some festival play, maybe had a little star or two, whatever, then that's why people are like, you gotta make your movie for like $200,000, $250,000, that kind of thing. And what types of movies are those? Those are smaller movies, smaller casts, you know,
smaller budgets,
unique kind of, you know, that kind of thing. So anyway.
One thing is that Gina Carey, I don't know if some of you have met her, she's shot like three or four indie